Evening. How are y'all feeling out there? Oh, that was kind of weak. How are y'all feeling out there?
Strong.
Let me ask you, how was the day's program? Can I have a round of applause? Have you gotten a second wind, or you needed this food right here? You needed the food. Great. Let me ask you one more question. Are you feeling the purpose of us coming here to Birmingham? To connect the two movements, this modern day movement that we have, to connect back to the history of the city and to those who've gone before? You guys are with me? Great. We've got an exciting program here for you tonight, and we've got some special guests in the room. So I just want, for their benefit, just to share the purpose of why we're here in Birmingham. We're really here to promote and celebrate this community empowerment plan that we've launched 4 years ago now, to create $50 billion of protection and tax-free future income into the African-American community. These agents in the room are really the ambassadors. These are the lead ambassadors of making this happen around the country. The opportunity for us to redirect for the 43 million African-Americans out there and our $1 trillion of earned income into tools and strategies to create wealth, to create legacies, to sustain families, and the organizations and institutions that we love, for the businesses that we start to continue on the legacy path. This is what we're committed to from the New York Life African American Market Unit. We've partnered with Mikey Anderson because we believe that another way to create jobs and empowerment and role models and successes in our community is to cycle our dollar back with black-owned businesses. So that's the program that we're embarked upon for the next 2 days. And we're going to have some great speakers here this evening. And to help move the program along, I'm going to bring one of our local agents, Jennifer Smith, from the Birmingham General Office, to come and introduce the mayor of the city.
Good evening. It is my honor to stand before my colleagues here in my hometown of Birmingham, Alabama, and introduce our mayor, Mayor William A. Bell Sr. He has a 30-year political career that spans of servitude to his constituents here in Birmingham. Excuse me. Mayor Bell is the 33rd mayor of the city of Birmingham. He is the proud father of Tony and Jillian Bell and the doting grandfather of two grandchildren. He told me to keep it short and sweet. We are so proud to have him as our mayor. Our city has grown in leaps and bounds under his leadership. So please welcome to the stage Mayor William A. Bell Sr.
Thank you, Jennifer. What she didn't complete was, I said, well, make it short because none of these folks vote for me anyway, because they'll be long out of here. So you don't have to lay all that other stuff, but I do see some of my constituency here, and I want to thank them for allowing me to represent this great city and to be the lead cheerleader for the great city of Birmingham, Alabama. I want to welcome you all here to this city. I want to welcome you back home. And you might say, well, why am I saying welcome you back home? All of you either work or affiliated in some way with New York Life. All of you have great business, professional careers. Wasn't like that back in the 60s and early 50s. I can recall here in Birmingham, Alabama, we used to have what we call the policy man, who would come around the house and your parents would either give him 50 cents or a dollar, and it was on a life insurance policy, and it was just enough to bury you. And that's all, just enough to bury you. And they would knock on your door, and you give them the money, and they'd go on off to Never Never Land, and you wouldn't really see them until it was time to bury somebody. That was the extent that the African-American community got involved with insurance companies. Dr. A.G. Gasson, a man who really saw a need and filled it in this community, he sought to educate African-Americans in this community to really think of insurance as something more than just being buried, something more than just taking care of an emergency need, but a way to create wealth. But you know, there was an issue here in the South that was an issue all across this country. Because the most that I could have hoped for when I was born into this society was to either get a job working in the mines, get a job working at what we call TCI as a laborer. TCI later on was bought out by U.S. Steel, or become a preacher, or if I was lucky, maybe go off to school somewhere and come back and be a doctor. But we only had like two or three doctors in this community when I was growing up. But for the most part, you were looking at becoming a laborer. And very few people got involved in the business community itself. But because of a man by the name of Fred Shuttlesworth, who invited Dr. Martin Luther King to come here to Birmingham to confront another gentleman by the name of Eugene Bull Connor, who was the symbol of racism in the South. And because of the number of untold foot soldiers who marched in the streets of Birmingham, who got their heads battered and bloodied, who made the sacrifice for me to stand here today as the 33rd mayor of a city that was once known as Birmingham, a city that represented the worst that humanity had to offer. Those individuals made that sacrifice for each and every one of us to participate in our society today. And so I want to welcome you back home, a home that gave you the opportunity to thrive and grow, the home that gave you the nourishment to do what you're doing today. The Birmingham that you may have thought of if this is your first visit is not the Birmingham that we have here today. We have a Birmingham that's progressive. We have a Birmingham that's growing by leaps and bounds. We have a Birmingham that all of our citizens can be proud of. And I tell people each and every day, I'm thankful. Thankful to represent this great city. Each and every day I get up, I put on my tutu, I grab my pom-poms, and I go out and talk about how great this community is. Because at the end of the day, it was the men and women of this community that said that we've got to change. We cannot have a society and a system of government that will allow our churches to be bombed on a Sunday morning. We cannot allow the individuals to roam the streets and openly brag about bombings and lynchings. We cannot allow the innocent lives of four little girls to be sacrificed and two young boys on the same day in this community simply because of the color of their skin. But both black and white, Baptists, Christians, Catholics, Jews, Muslim, people of all religious backgrounds came together and said, we're going to change Birmingham. We're going to make it a city that you can live up to your potential. You don't have to worry about only having the option of being a laborer in the mines or at the steel mills. That you can be whatever your talents will allow you to be. But you got to do more than just use your talents. You got to think about future generations as well. And that's where your job comes into play. One of the biggest issues that we have in this community today is abandoned homes. Why do we have abandoned homes in our community? Because people die without wills. People die without the financial wealth being passed on to the next generation. And we've got to educate people that that's not the way to do business. You've got to be able to pass on something to the next generation, a legacy, if you will. And it's your job and your responsibility, yes. It's your job and your responsibility to reach out and grab those individuals and say, let me show you a better way of doing things. That it's not just about will you be buried without leaving a debt to your family. That it's about passing on generational wealth, that the next generation can be better off than you are. I hope that my grandsons, my two grandsons that I'm so proud of, one is 4 years old, the other one is 6 months old, will have a much better life than I've had, and I've had a great life. But it's up to me and my son to make sure that we pass on the tools and the support necessary for them to reach that next level. Every generation should reach a higher level than the generation in the past. And you know, you all got the tools to help us do that. And you've got to educate us. You've got to grab us by the hand and take us down that road and show us the way. And if you do that, we can make all of our communities stronger. We can make all of our citizens full participants in this society. So I want to thank each and every one of you all for being here in Birmingham. I want to thank you for coming here to have this exchange of knowledge with our citizens, to commiserate with each other and talk about how you can be more effective. And I want to thank Jennifer for working so hard to bring you all here during the 50th anniversary of the march in Selma. Last year we celebrated the 50th, in 2013, we not celebrated, but we commemorated 1963, a very tumultuous time, a time that changed America, a time that brought about the change in this country that was so powerful that a man named Nelson Mandela, when he came to Atlanta in 1993, said that the one thing that gave him hope and encouragement while he was in prison in Robben Island for 26 years was that if change could come to Birmingham in the American South, then change could come to South Africa. That's the power of the movement that happened in this city right here in Birmingham, Alabama. So I want to welcome you all to be here, and thank you, Jennifer, for fighting so hard. I want to give her a big round of applause. I want to ask Jennifer and Eugene if they would please come up. I'd like to present a proclamation to them at this time. Eugene got one of those big old long titles, you know. Bottom line is, he in charge of making sure African Americans get a piece of the pie. That's what his title is. Eugene, I want to thank you for being here. And on behalf of the citizens of the great city of Birmingham, Alabama, we have this proclamation, and it reads, whereas the city of Birmingham is pleased to join the New York Life Insurance Company in a national campaign to change the financial future of African Americans throughout the Birmingham region. And whereas starting in 2011, the New York Life's Community Empowerment Plan is a national initiative to create a collective $50 billion of protection and generally tax-free future income throughout African American communities around the country. And whereas the pulse of this initiative is New York Life's 1,100 African American market agents around the country who have rallied around a movement to touch a collective 200,000 African American lives, showing each individual how purchasing at least $250,000 of life insurance today could help ensure a college education, home ownership, entrepreneurial endeavors, and even multi-generational assets in the future. And whereas the proponent of the $50 billion empowerment plan, the city of Birmingham recognized the need to begin creating legacies and building multi-generational financial security throughout Birmingham's African American community. And whereas each generation of African American communities stands proudly on the legacy of everyday heroes and civil rights leaders, together through programs such as those offered by New York Life, we can ensure the stability of the African American community for years to come, help create economic opportunity, and begin building multi-generational wealth. Now, therefore, I, William A. Bell Sr., Mayor of the City of Birmingham, Alabama, do hereby proclaim February 17, 2015, as $50 billion Empowerment Day in Birmingham in recognition of New York Life Insurance Company's African American Community Empowerment Plan. And let me just say in closing, I know we have Cassius Butts with the Small Business Administration, who has worked tremendously throughout the Southern District to help create economic opportunities for so many people. And I want to welcome Cassius back here. I see my good friend Mike Roberts. I think, Mike, what year was that you were up in Washington trying to get the FCC to give you that license? Was that 85, 84?
Yeah, something like that.
Something like that. I think Mike had about 50 bucks in his pocket and was looking all pitiful and everything. He went up there and convinced those folks to give him a cellular license, and look at him now. You go, boy. That's the kind of entrepreneurial spirit that we want to instill in all of our people. That it's not just about having a job. It's about creating a future for you, your family, and generations to come. So thank you all for being here in this great city. Thank you all for the work that you're doing. Thank you for empowering the African American community. Thank you.
I have the great honor of introducing this evening from the New York Life side, our highest ranking African American at the company. And to bring him to the stage, please, I'm gonna ask the second highest ranking, Troy Glover. He spoke earlier today, a great ally and partner of mine. I'm really proud of the successes that you've had at the company, Troy, and please join me on the stage.
Thanks, Eugene, I really appreciate that. So like I said earlier today, no introduction by Rod, who said I was the highest ranking African American at the company. That's not true. And like I said, George Nichols is, and I have the pleasure of knowing George since I started with New York Life. So I've been with New York Life for 15 years. George has been a friend, a mentor, a confidant, and I'm really proud of him. So George is not only the most senior ranking African American at the company, but he also sits on our executive management committee, which is for some of the most senior leadership members of New York Life. So I always like to make that distinction, because we always talk about one of the black African Americans, but let's be clear. George is one of the most senior ranking officers of our company, and George does a great job. He's senior vice president in charge of our Office of Governmental Affairs. And prior to that, he was actually commissioner in the state of Kentucky, also insurance commissioner. So it is my pleasure to welcome up my friend, George Nichols.
How's everybody doing? You know, I'm from Kentucky, and we don't get to have a lot of events where you can come in and stand before a crowd of professional, good-looking, successful African Americans. So this does me proud tonight. Mayor, thank you. You know, I don't know about you all, but if you think about the history of this country and the history of our community, and then to sit here and hear an African-American mayor of a place we read about, that in itself is inspiring. Thank you, sir, for having us. Troy, thank you. Now, you all notice that Troy and Eugene and I have the same haircut. I know some others in here to go to the same barber that we go to, you know? So I appreciate that. It's not the look of New York Life, but it just so happens it works out that way. I want to first congratulate all of you for the work that you've done. Now stop and think about this. 5 years ago, there was a vision. And the vision was, let's create a movement where that we go out as a company, we get African-American agents, and we ask them to go out and empower the people in our community. Now, it's not like we pulled a $50 billion number out of the sky. There was meaning to it. And Eugene has done a great job of leadership to sell you on it, to get you to buy into it, and then to get you to do something about it. And to think about 5 years into this vision, you have now reached $27 billion. You're over half there. And Eugene and I were talking the other day, and I said, the question is, you did this in five, so that means you should reach your 50 in five. But I have to believe that with the hard work and success that you've already achieved, it will be less than 5 years that we will be celebrating the 50. Now, I also want to tell you that, as Troy mentioned, I am a member of the Executive Management Committee for New York Life. I just came from Florida from the New York Life board meeting, and there was a discussion yesterday on the strategy for our life and annuity business and agency. And in that discussion, we had set out an hour and a half to talk about the strategies for the next 3 years. 45 minutes of that was spent on the discussion around cultural markets. Everything that we want to do as a company hinges on the success of what you do in your business. Now, New York Life is 169 years old. Unfortunately, and fortunately, we've been a part of every history you can imagine. Slavery, Jim Crow, the Civil War, World Wars, all of that, we were there. Think about it. We were there. That's how old we are. Almost as old as this country is. We believe we'll be around another 169 years. And to think that our future is in this room. Our future is in rooms just like this that have people of color in it. Our growth in manpower, our growth in agents, our growth in going out and teaching people the value of the financial security will be people of color. Now, I can assure you, I feel pretty confident in saying 169 years ago, no one thought about that. I can't believe the board of directors were in New York City and said, you know what, one day we're going to worry about the people who are sold down in Wall Street. Our future would be on their backs, but that is the truth. I have the distinct honor of being the first black to ever serve on the Executive Management Committee of New York Life. Now, my father said to me, "Aren't you proud, son?" And I said, "Dad, I don't know. Why they have to go get a board from Kentucky? And why did it take this long?" But never should I worry about why it took so long, as I should be focused on what am I to do about this. That is why I'm here tonight. I want you to be successful. I want to show you my support. You know, it's funny, when we talk about $50 billion, I actually was catching up on my magazines, and I was on the flight here, and I pulled out Forbes. And it had their 400 richest Americans. They're all billionaires, with the B. There's only one African American on the list this year. The cutoff was $1.5 billion, so Michael Jordan fell off. He was only at one. Oprah Winfrey was the only one on the list. The only one on the list. And I thought it was interesting. I wanted to share with you what she said. "I am grateful for the blessings of wealth, but it hasn't changed who I am. My feet are still on the ground. I'm just wearing better shoes." But then I found another intriguing thing. I read about the first black billionaire. Do you know what year we had our first black billionaire? 2001. Bob Johnson, BET. That's not long ago, is it? Now, the reason I wanted to share that with you is 2001, 14 years ago, we had our first black billionaire in this country. Today, on the list, we only have one. She's female. She's done well. Her net worth is $3 billion. And then we have a subset of people who are focused on creating $50 billion of wealth among our people. Now I'm waiting for Forbes to write about that. Now, I want you to know that what you're doing will create success for you. It will. It will create success for our families, for our community. But here's the thing that I do not want you to think about in the context of your success for yourself or for the families and the lives that you bring this empowerment to. This is not about money. Money is paper. It is a currency. That is all that it is. This is about a legacy. And a legacy is about how you are remembered, what you leave behind. None of you will live forever. You will be judged, you will be evaluated and thought of based on what you did in the moment and times of which you had on this earth. This is what I want to share with you. My mother told me to remember one thing. It is better to be known by a good name than of great wealth. So I want you to take your name and the New York Life name, and I want you to take it out and do good. That's what I want you to do. Do good. Leave that legacy. I do not want our people to be poor in the future. I want them to have money to create more billionaires who turn around and create more billionaires who turn around and make our people great. We are part of America. We're a big part of America. You're a big part of New York Life. Take this opportunity. Follow Eugene's lead. Believe in this movement. It is critical that you do. I listened to the mayor talk about the history of this city, the bombings, the loss of life. We could have stopped. We could have given up. We could have not fought. But that's not who we are. I'm saying that to you because I don't want any of you to quit. I don't know where you are in your development. I don't know where you are in your practice. But don't come back here in a year or go somewhere else in a year. And some of you are not sitting out there. Don't give up. Don't quit. Because there's more than just you that's depending on this. There are families out there that are depending on this. There's a 4-year-old depending on this. There's a 6-month-old depending on this. There's a son, there's a daughter, there's a father, a mother, and grandparents. Depending on you, doing what you do every single day, bringing financial security to people. And I want you to bring it to our people because I don't want to be the last African-American EMC member at New York Life. I'd love to see the board all African-Americans. I'd love to see the EMC all African-Americans. And the only way we can achieve that is that each one of us do our part. Thank you for letting me be a part of this historic event. I hope that 5 years, 10 years, 15 years from now, we're talking about, do you remember Birmingham?
Good evening. First of all, I want to let Anika know that's the second best introduction, Mayor Bell, that I ever had. Because the first one was a couple weeks ago when the person supposed to introduce me didn't show up and I had to introduce myself. So, it's the second best introduction. Well, I mean, I don't know how you come in front of all these great speakers tonight, and protocol has been established, and I can just tell you that I'm excited. Tell somebody next to you, say, I'm excited. I mean, we're talking about some serious stuff here now, $50 billion. I mean, Mayor, when they came to the mayor's office and they told us to come into the conference room, the question I was trying to do was to figure out, I did the three W's. And in doing those three W's, I was trying to figure out who, what, and after the presentation, I said, wow. And I can tell you that light bulbs went off where this thing could go and who we could engage in this conversation. And so I wanted to preface my remarks, because the time has been well spent. I wanted to preface my remarks. There's a gym that I go to, and on the wall, it has intensity plus commitment equals results. And Eugene, every time I'm ready to get off the treadmill, that sign is right there, you know. Intensity plus commitment equals results. All right? Not like one guy I saw came to the gym, he got off the treadmill, he went and got on the scale, he got off, he went back and got on the scale. And I was trying to get him to see that sign, but I didn't know the guy. You know, and you've been elected official, you got to be careful. So I didn't know the guy, Mayor Ben, so I didn't say nothing. But I wanted to say, why don't you just stay on the treadmill and read that, and something happened. But this movement that we're talking about tonight, I think about the four P's, and that's what I want to preface my remarks around. That's what I want to hang my head at tonight. I wanted to say to you that when you have persistence, be positive, right? Passion, and then you gotta be patient, all right? Now, some people would say, why you didn't put power in there? Or why you didn't put purpose in there, all right? Because I found out that when you say something about passion, that means that you're sympathetic to the cause, right? But if you compassion, you're going to do something, right? And guess what? You all who are in this room, y'all have done something. Y'all have raised the stakes. I mean, I go to a lot of conferences, involved in a lot of groups and stuff there, but you're the first one to talk about the economic situation of our people. Because for a long time in our community, when someone die, they get chicken, the cake, but guess what? It's now time to get the check. Huh? The three C's. The chicken, the cake, it depends on which one. I mean, you know, you got a hospitality group at the church, so you might get the chicken. But I'm talking about somebody coming to your house, they come in with the chicken. But it's very few people come with the check. And I think that's what y'all are on to here tonight, and what you're going to be doing all through this week. But the other thing is, you can't be what you can't see. And I think that's where I heard somebody talk about the disconnect, when we talk about the disconnect. Because we're too disconnected from our community. We got to get proximity to the people in the community. And you got something here that can do that. This is one thing that brings people together when you start talking about money. That brings us together. But without your leadership, though, in the community, because we're so disconnected. Mayor, we're just too disconnected from each other. And we got to get connected. And I'm glad to see that y'all having that conference here, the A.J. Gaston conference here. That's the kind of things we're talking about. I think we got it on the political side. I think we got it on the educational side, but we're missing it on that economic side. And this product will take us to where we need to be. Right? So instead of us being bitter, I thought about it as I was on the plane today. I just want to change one letter in there. I want to take the I out and put an E in there. It's time for us to be better. And we can do that. We can do that. So let me just talk about that purpose. See, because once we realize we have a purpose, I think I got something here I could. When we start talking about the purpose, right? When we know what our purpose is, we can take this thing to the next level. Right? When we know what our purpose is. Somebody say purpose. We got to know what our purpose is. Because guess what? You just have a birth date, and then you're going to have what, a death date. And in between, you got that dash. Now, see, when I was in the legislature, we made sure that happened. Because we determined that when somebody was born, they got a birth certificate. Yeah, well. And when they died, they got what? A death certificate. But guess what? The dash in between would determine who would show up at your funeral. Because see, I got some friends, boy, they'll tell you quick. Me and my family doing well, the rest of y'all go to hell. Oh, some of y'all can get that in the morning, they're gonna hit you. Me and my folk and no more. Right? I used to deal with some people like that. They didn't care anything about anybody else. And they're like, the more we get disconnected from each other, that's the way it is. We're only concerned about the elected official when something happened to me. Right? Nobody's in the struggle. Nobody's in the battle. But here tonight, y'all getting ready to start a movement. Because for 10 years from now, or 5 years from now, or 20 years from now, somebody's going to say, you know what? Y'all made a difference. Y'all were able to keep an HBCU open. We got a lot of them in the South, y'all. I know in Florida we have a lot of them. And we need us to write the checks. See, because a lot of my friends, when they were in the legislature, I started telling them one day, y'all kidnapped us. No, they said, no, we rescued you. We used to talk about reparation. They said, no, you owe us for the boat fare across the Atlantic. That's the kind of folks I was dealing with in the legislature. We mentioned reparation. Because how many people saw the movie Rosewood? I mean, saw that movie Rosewood. You know, that happened in Florida, right? Came in there, wiped the town out and everything there, and we were trying to get reparation. And we had a couple of colleagues jump up and say, no, you owe us. But we were able to move forward with that and get reparation for the Rosewood family. Every descendant of a Rosewood family member can go to college free in the state of Florida. Every descendant. We're the first state I know of in this country to give reparation to African Americans. They tried to do it in Arkansas, Oklahoma, and they were beat back a little bit, but we stuck together. But I had some colleagues that had that other mindset. So it goes back to what I'm telling you when I'm in the gym. Intensity plus commitment equals results. But we gotta be committed. We gotta be committed. So I want to just throw out a few things to you tonight and get out of your way. Helen Keller was once asked, what would be worse than being blind? And she quoted back to him, to have sight but no vision. I want to just thank Rod and I want to thank Eugene for a vision. They gave us the vision. Now all we got to do is run with it, right? We gotta run with it. But then we gotta also be excited. Because when I saw this plan, all I could think about, and my background is the labor movement, all I could think about was the A. Philip Randolph Institute. We have the Coalition of Black Trade Union. We had some locals with 250,000 members. And I know when they go to the bargain table, nobody is talking about life insurance. They're not talking about it. And that should be an issue that is raised, wouldn't you agree? I'm talking to the wrong crowd today. I can tell you, 250,000 members in one local, and nobody's talking about life insurance. They should be talking about that. So immediately I said to Eugene, there's a conference in Las Vegas. I'm going to try to hook you up so you can go there. But I found out one thing. You can take a horse to the well, but don't mean you're going to drink.
right? This thing is kind of new, y'all. Because you know how we are, we skeptical. You know, remember I told you chicken, the cake, ain't no check though. So we kind of skeptical about that. And so Eugene, I said, Eugene, I think we can go to the next level with this. And I really believe that today, that not only just New York Life, but other agents across, because this thing is too big just for one company. Huh? Somebody woke up. Somebody took that eye out and put an E in there. Gonna be better. All right, you can have it. All right. Because I'm telling y'all, this thing is a kept secret, but it's getting ready to get out. Because somebody gonna go back and tell somebody y'all was here in Birmingham, and you weren't here to have a party. We was here to talk about economic death. And we were down here to talk about social justice. We were here to talk about economic justice. That's the last hurdle for us to go over. And y'all are here to make that happen. So let me just kind of cut across the field. Right? And somebody said Rudy. Y'all know Rudy? Alright. Go to show y'all, I go to church, y'all. But here's the thing. Not everything in life that you approach can be changed. Would you agree to that? But guess what? Nothing be changed until you approach it. And that's what y'all doing. Y'all are doing that. And we're looking for you for leadership. We're looking for this room here next time we meet next year to come with those reports of $1 million contract, $1 million policies. Right? See, it's one thing for us to be on this social issue, but it's another thing to make money and be social. Right? And so as I think about Rod and them coming into Jacksonville and Maggie coming with the conference there and stuff, and Anika asked me, where could we have this at? I said, well, let's think about it. Because we want people to not say, hey, it was in a little small place. We want to have it. We went down to the community college, y'all, to the auditorium. And let me tell you something. Those folks that don't look like me were looking and watching. Because there wasn't no music being played. We weren't doing anything crazy. We was in there talking about wealth. Building wealth, talking about how we be our brother's keeper who are in businesses, in our community, that are hiring people that look like us in our community. And some of them are here today that are doing that. But now you're talking about something that I can tell my grand, I mean, I called my daughter, because I wanted to see what she owned this thing. And she said, Daddy, I was just getting ready to call you. Her father-in-law passed away. And he left the same amount of inheritance to the daughters and his son that he left my daughter. And they were able to put down their house. Isn't that what we're talking about, folks? He left that for them. She said, Dad, I'll tell you a little later how much it was, but he left that. Because I wanted to ask how much was it there, you know? Because what I did was I called them and I said, baby, I want you and Cicely and Tiffany. I got to bring JR on a little bit, but Cicely and Tiffany, I said, I want y'all to take an insurance policy out on your dad. I said, I'm not on diabetes. I'm gonna work out at the gym. I'm pretty healthy and stuff there. Go ahead on and take it out. Y'all pay for it. They got about $500,000 on me. Then y'all split it. Now, isn't that leaving a legacy? Huh? Why y'all laughing at that? Y'all you want me to pay for that? Huh? Okay, well, $2 million. I told them, hey, just let me know where you want me to show up to take the physical and everything. Let's do it. Let's make it happen. But guess what? I was not consciously thinking of that until Maggie and Jean and Rodney came to Jacksonville. I wasn't thinking about that. Because I had now go back and check with Mom, who is around 10, 15, 20,000, right? So now I'm getting with Anika, and she hooking me up and everything. We got a meeting, that's why she gave that great introduction. She gonna get me.
So I gotta get ready, because she's been to do it, but I gotta figure that out. And so what I'm saying to you tonight is, you're on to something. Now it's just, we gotta keep the purpose. We got the power, because we knew where the power came from, right? Right? And we gotta be passionate. See, because one thing I've realized in life, if you get excited, other people gonna get excited. See, when I called up to headquarters there, the A. Philip Randolph Institute, and said, hey, I got some guys I want y'all to meet and everything, they said, Tony, you excited about what we meet with? See, but you gotta be excited. It's almost like us going out here right now in the middle of the street here. I don't know what the name of the street is. Who's from Birmingham here? Mayor Harrington Boulevard, and start looking up. I guarantee you, 10 people get out their car and start looking up Brett Richmond. Because they're ready to follow somebody. People are ready to follow somebody. And they will follow you if you're going somewhere. And guess what, New York Life? Y'all going somewhere. Y'all are going somewhere.
So let me close on up, cause, so the mayor won't call my mayor and say, that boy you got was talking long-winded over there. So I know he heads up the black mayors there and stuff there. Right, you the chair, right, Brother Bell? Chair of, you know, our mayor is the chair of the black mayors of Conference of Mayors. Let's give him a hand. let me just close on this thought with you, because this thing is, it's getting exciting. I want you to think about this. There were once lived a wise elderly woman, and she had lived in the same house for the entire life. And every day, y'all, when she woke, she would say good morning to her beautiful parakeet named Agape. The woman would put Agape in the window so she could enjoy the sun and the fresh air. And the elderly woman would then go about her daily chores. And all the people who lived in that neighborhood or in that village knew about the elderly woman and her bird, Agape. So one day, two young men decided that they were going to break into the elderly woman's house. Isn't that something, young? While she was away, and steal a bird. They decided that when she returned, they would approach her and say, "Old woman, we have your bird. Is it dead or alive?" Think about that. If the old woman replied dead, the young men decided that they would open their hand and let Agape fly away. And if the old woman replied alive, they would crush Agape dead and drop her at the feet of the elderly woman. Just as they had planned, the two boys waited for the elderly woman to leave her house to do her daily chores. And when the elderly woman left, they broke into the house and stole Agape. And when she returned, she found that the house had been broken into and Agape's empty cage was on the floor. And just as the two boys had planned, they approached the elderly woman and said, "Old woman, we have your bird. Is it dead or alive?" And the wise woman, or should I say the wise elderly woman, paused for a moment and looked at the ground. Then, with carrying her eyes, she looked at the boys and slowly answered, "I don't know. It's in your hands." This is what we're talking about tonight, y'all. Is in your hands. It's in your hands. But guess what? You got to finish strong. You got to finish strong. And I want y'all to listen to this. You got to finish strong. This is too important. Now, some of y'all, if you're not scared, now get up. I know y'all don't heard of Jonathan Nelson down out of Florida.
In this race that we run, you gotta have endurance, 'cause it's a marathon. I was born, shown up to win. Pursuit with faith.
Can you turn it up?
Until the end, I'm going to have a strong.
Come on, I heard somebody say we had to finish strong. Come on.
I'm going to have a
strong finish.
I have
strong faith.
I'm going to have a
strong finish.
Cause I have
strong faith.
I'm going to have a
strong finish.
I have
strong faith.
Life's transitions all in my way, but still I'm onward bound
each and every day.
No matter what, I'll continue to run for the rest of my life.
So I simply want to close with you tonight, because as you are over here for the next 2 or 3 days, and you got to finish strong. Margaret Mead once said, never doubt that a small group of concerned citizens, and I'm going to take the concerned citizens out and say concerned agents, can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. And you can do it. You can do it. And the way we do it, I heard somebody say making the buddy check, calling in, being accountable. Because I'm telling you, our great-grandchildren will one day say that, hey, they met there in Birmingham. This is where it all started at. This is where the legacy started at. This is where when your great-great-grandson said, you know what, my great-granddaddy left something. See, I saw that when I saw this program. Because when I was in the legislature, every time I go on the floor, if one of the colleagues would come in there and say, you know, see that guy up there? That's my great-great-granddaddy was serving in the legislature. Now, guess what, y'all? When my great-great-granddaddy, they go on that floor, they say, my granddaddy was up there. That's what this is all about, folks. It's about leaving something for those who are coming behind us, because we're standing on some shoulders. But guess what? You can't be what you can't see. They got to see you. They got to see you. There was a young man that went to Barney's in New York. Y'all ever been to Barney's in New York? And he bought a Ferragamo belt. Bought a Ferragamo belt. And the people just followed him all over the place. Wanted to know why. How you buy that belt? Right? Oh. Wanted to know why he bought that belt. Wanted to know why he bought the belt. So they followed him all over the store. And he turned around, you know, somebody, you know when somebody followed you, right? He said, can I help you? Did I do something wrong? He said, no, we want to know why you bought that belt. And the young man said, I don't know if it was one of the fast food chains or what. He said, I like that belt and I want it. But guess what he said? I bought it because I saw the wrapper with it on. See, you can't be what you can't see. So our kids are going to see people, and they're going to duplicate what they see. So wouldn't it be nice for them to see you in their rooms, in their living rooms, writing these million-dollar insurance policies? And then they can grow up and be like that, right? Because that's what it's all about, leaving a legacy. So when somebody comes on behind you, they can say, hey, that's somebody in my family. They can identify. It don't have to be always in the majority community to identify. We can identify in our community. Remember I told you about the chicken? We can move away from the chicken in the cake and go to the check.
That's right.
That's what my daughter did. They bought that house. They said, Dad, because you know you can't do 100%.
100% financed, no one's gonna put something down. So that's what they, but somebody thought enough to leave them something. And that's what we gotta do, right? It's time out for us playing games. As I used to tell them in the legislature, it's time out for laughing, there ain't nothing funny. And scratching, there ain't nothing itchy. Right? Because we're only here, and we're all Esthers. We're here for such a time as this. It could have been somebody else, but you were chosen. Right? Now it's time for you to come up. Right? Life is equally balanced between good and evil. When y'all leave this conference, you'll tip the scale.